ask the Cajun lady. She'll tell me. Ah, all right. Check that out, our new fancy sign. Well, good morning, Mosaic, out there in, Facebook land? We're glad you're here. All right, y'all ready? Let's do a little worshiping today. Well, again, thank you for joining us online. We appreciate you. And, of course, here in Mosaic, we're glad y'all are here as well. This is our first two Go Waymaker. We hope that you enjoy it, and we invite you to stand if you feel so led.
Never stop working. Even when when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop. Would you join us? Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop. Amen. God is here. You may be seated.
So y'all are in for a treat because I have little to no voice because of allergies, and then I yelled at my TV a lot last night, but LSU won. My name is Jennifer Snyder. I am the director of children's ministries here at First Methodist Sherman, and I wanted to say welcome to Mosaic. If you are worshiping online, good morning. Please sign in on the comments, that way we know you're here. If you're worshiping here in space with us, there are little black books. If you go ahead and sign in that way we can go ahead and get your attendance logged. Sorry. There are offering bowls in the back of the service. One's over here and one is over there. There is also a prayer table in the back. We are a staff that prays, and they are always prayed over in our staff meetings. It's one of the greatest things about working here is we do take this very seriously. We always pray over everything. I have one announcement, and that is on 11/20, on November 20, 11/20, November 20th, we're going to have a fellowship meal in our CCLC, and that is going to be at noon. The church is going to provide the meat. You guys provide the sides and the desserts. It's awesome. So if you would like to go ahead and be here for that, we would greatly appreciate it because it's an awesome time for us to spend time together as one church. But the only thing is just if you can, just bring a side or a dessert. And then now I'm going to bring up Reverend Denise to make another announcement.
I promise this will be very quick this morning. While I was away last week, our jurisdictional conference, and if you want to know all the parts of the conference that there are, I'm happy to have that conversation with you at another time. But our jurisdictional conference met for the first time since 2016 to elect bishops. And so at the end of this year, Mike McKee, our current bishop, will be retiring. And Bishop Reuben Saenz, it's spelled S-A-E-N-Z, but Bishop Reuben Saenz will be appointed as Bishop of the North Texas Conference. There is a notice on the traditional website and the Mosaic website. If you want a little bit of his background, it will be there. We are very excited to have him coming to be our new bishop. He is a great man who has had great ministry experience throughout the United States and the United Methodist Church. And so I hope that in January, when he gets here, we may have the opportunity to have him visit with us one day. I think that would be a great opportunity for us to hear his vision and his mission for the United Methodist Church as we move forward. So thank you for that moment of pastoral privilege. And I'm going to invite Jenny Reynolds up quickly to give us an update on our prayer cards. And then Jerry Holbert and Ann Webb will be up to give one more announcement.
All right, this week our word is courage. It's kind of the pinkish-reddish card. And I just want to take a moment. Yesterday we had the prayer vigil on the main campus, and I was there for the majority of the day. That was such a neat experience. It was a small, steady trickle all day long of people coming in, spending time quietly praying for our church, praying for this campaign, praying for whatever was on their hearts. Some people were at home and couldn't make it, but they still let me know that they had taken 30 minutes of their time to pray as well. And I just think that it was a very neat experience that we got to have. So thank you for those that participated.
Can you hear me? All right. Yes. Good morning. My name is Ann Webb, for those of you that don't know me. And I've been a member of First Methodist since 1980-something. And during those years, I've worn different hats. Right now, I'm one of the children's Sunday school teachers. And then I'm the chairman of the finance committee. And I bet you can guess which one I prefer. Okay, so you're going to get in the mail a card with two boxes on it. One of them is going to be for a pledge for the operating budget, and the other is for the pledge for our debt. Now, we know about operating budgets, right? And we have to increase it a little bit because things happen and expenses go up. And so think about that when you do that. Now, the second one is the debt, and I have to be careful because sometimes I talk really fast. So the debt, Jana knows me. So I don't like the word debt because debt is negative, right? So just humor me. And from now on, instead of saying debt, say appreciative payment for the good things that we are reaping from all the renovations that were done on the main campus. We no longer have an ugly, deadly garage. We have a nice parking lot. We have beautiful grounds. The worship space here and over there is a great place for us to give glory to God, right? So we should be happy about paying for what we're getting that happened a long time ago. Now, First Methodist, I think, is one of the leading churches in the community that gives and does. So we started Great Days of Service a long time ago, Grand Central Station, Children's Express. And we want to do more because y'all have turned in requests of what you'd like for us to do, both at roundtable and after Denise's sermon. I know I'm going too long, but I'll get to the point. Okay. Okay. So in order to do all those things, we do have to have finances, right? Now, the other thing that shows that we are the leaders in this community is if you're on 75 going either north or south and you look towards our church, you see our steeple. Our steeple is the highest steeple around. That shows that God is in this place and that we worship God. So that just shows we're there. We got to keep going, right? We've got to keep the leadership of service. Now, as I said, I'm one of the children's Sunday school teachers, and one of the privileges I have is I get to choose the curriculum every Sunday. And so usually it's a Bible study from the Old or the New Testament. But this week, on Monday, actually, a verse popped in my head, and it was 1 Thessalonians 5. Now, we're also talking about God winks. This was my God wink, because when I opened the email from church, what was the verse? 1 Thessalonians 5. Now, what is that verse? That verse says to rejoice constantly, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Jesus Christ. So if we rejoice as we make our payments, if we pray trying to decide, well, how do I do, how much do I give? Pray about it. God will tell you. If you just are quiet and pray, the Holy Spirit in you will whisper to you, telling you what to do. And then, of course, give thanks in all circumstances. We are so lucky. We are able to pray in public. We are able to worship in public. We don't have to go hide, right? So we need to keep this going. We need to stay being the leaders in the community and pray with God. Now, we're also supposed to be, I always have to look at this one. make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world to the glory of God. Now, I have a pretzel, and I was going to pass them out, but I got here late because I had to take care of my kids. If you look at a pretzel, if you look at a pretzel, it's got arms like this, and it's like this. So that's praying. And then if you look at the outside, it's a heart, but it's also a continuous circle. So this reminds you that you should pray continually. Okay, Jerry, you're up.
I'm so glad to be with you here today. It's going to take me a little while before I can't keep up with Ann. No way. No way. We love you, Ann. Thank you. Thank you. Well, good morning, First United Methodist Church Mosaic. I'm glad to be with you again today. And I do look at this building and at this ministry and think how there were sacrifices made in past years that allowed for all this to happen, and we're grateful for that. And so today is All Saints Sunday, and that always, I love All Saints Sunday because it gives us an opportunity to reflect on what those who have come before us have done. And we remember them, whether it's just family members, that's important, or whether it's family members within the body of Christ of this church. And we stop and we remember them and what they did and how important they were. Because we are the beneficiaries right now of the sacrifices and the generosity that they made in years past. And so I think that, you know, when I think about the influence of this church, one of the things that drew me to this church, because I was in Sherman, 8 years before we actually came to this church. And there are five churches that think we're members. We looked around, you know, visited, checked there, we see what's going on. And we came, and one of the things that drew us to this church were the ministries. Because when I was at Austin College, we were always a part of Great Days of Service, which was started by this church and was important to the community. And then we have Grand Central Station that was started by folks in this church and has grown and grown and grown. Right now, they're doing about 150 to 160 hot lunches per day, and about 80 breakfasts every day. And they're packing for 800 school children to have meals over the weekend. I mean, this is important, and that came out of this church. And then Family Promise that we're doing now. All of those were started before. Those are the kind of ministries that, given the right kinds of funds, we would be able to not only continue, but to grow and to reach more people for Christ, as Ann said. Because that's the way Christ sees our, people see our actions. And I remember Emerson's great quote Emerson's great quote that said, your actions speak so loudly, I can't hear what you're saying. Right? That's what, we want our actions to speak so loudly that people say, this is important, and it draws them to Christ. This week you're going to be receiving your commitment cards. I want you to prayerfully consider your participation in this campaign. 100% participation would be fabulous, and it would demonstrate the commitment of this church as a whole. And I want to emphasize, every gift is important. Every gift is important. We don't measure it by size. It's the heart that's giving. It's like the widow's mite, or else who was the rich guy that gave Jesus's tomb? Yeah, I mean, there's a rich guy, and he gave something that was important and continued to give. And so in the early church, there were those who could give little and those who could give greatly. And they were all beloved and important to the church. Every gift is important. So please, as you get ready to come next Sunday, Commitment Sunday, and give your card, or whether you go online or whether you come by the church, there's now a slot outside. So in the hall, even if the church office is not open, you can slip your commitment card in there, or you can slip all kinds of things in there. I guess if it fits, slip it in there. So anyway, I mean, this is coming up on Commitment Sunday. we're going to be, it's going to be a celebration in my mind. It's going to be a celebration. And I was looking at the poet in Ecclesiastes, and you know this very well. To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. This is the time for us. Thank you.
On the note of slipping things into the slot, the staff takes CJ's gift cards. Anyways. Hey, everybody. My name is Laura Muller, and I am the Youth Director and Director of Communications. If you will please stand and join me in our statement of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Then he who had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid, and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. The third servant had something that the other two servants didn't have that was a key to holding him back. Fear. One of the main indicators that someone is operating out of fear is when they make excuses versus taking action. The first two servants got right to work and took action. However, the third servant started making excuses when it was time for him to account for what he had or had not done. There is nothing that will rob us of opportunity and stand in the way of us being courageously generous, more than being afraid. We are invited to enter in to courage.
The week before I left for the trip, I started thinking about today's sermon. Because All Saints is an important day, it's very important to me personally, and I know for those of you sitting in this room for whom you have friends and family members who have gone on to glory, not just this year, but in the past, whose memories are alive and well in your hearts, All Saints is an important day. It's just an important day. So I had to make a decision. Would I continue in Matthew 25 one more week, or would we move on? And we are moving on today. And we're going to, you'll hear some themes about where we are and what we're doing, but you'll also hear some words, I hope, of encouragement and words of hope for our future. I'm going to be preaching from the very familiar text from the book of Esther, and I'm just going to set that text up a little bit before I read it. Esther was the queen of Persia under the rule of Xerxes. She came to power, or she came into that position, because Vashti, Xerxes' first wife, refused to parade naked around a bunch of drunken men. And so for her common sense, she was banished. And Esther won the beauty pageant. There were hundreds of women brought in. There was a beauty pageant held. Xerxes picked Esther. Go figure. In the meantime, there was a man who was considered a high noble, part of that leadership, who really was very full of himself. He was, you could say, a narcissist. Maybe not quite a narcissist, but when you get angry because people aren't bowing down to you as you pass them on the street, I think if the term fits, and so it sort of does here. And so he got mad because Mordecai, Esther's cousin, would not bow down to him. And so he goes to King Xerxes and says to Xerxes, listen, this Jew Mordecai is standing outside the gate and he refuses to bow down. And by the way, he's not just, does he not want to follow the rules, but no Jew wants to follow the rules. You're not going to find this exact paraphrase in the Bible, by the way. No Jew wants to bow down. No Jew wants to follow the law. And so if you say that it's okay to kill all the Jews, I will make an offering to you. And so Xerxes rolls the dice, literally rolls dice, and chooses the date that common people can go ahead and kill all the Jews in their towns and plunder their goods. This is really not a nice story up to this point, right? So Mordecai finds out about this and goes into mourning, puts on sackcloth and ashes. All the Jews in the area are putting on sackcloth and ashes because their deaths are pending. And he sends a message to his cousin, the queen, Esther, and says to her, you know, these terrible things are happening and you need to intervene. She sends back the messenger who says, no, because I have not gone in front of the king for 30 days and he hasn't called me. And you know, unless the king calls you, you can't go see him. And if you go see him, then he'll kill you. She has the right to be afraid here. Okay, she's lived in the palace for a number of years. She's probably seen this happen. She doesn't want to be the next one. Mordecai is not going to take no for an answer. So he sends the messenger back to her, and there's a brief response here, and I'm going to read these four verses from Esther 4, verses 13 through 17. You are going to know some of this. It is some of the most cliche sayings that we use even today that come right out of the scripture. You might not have known that. So listen now to these words. Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise from the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for such a time as this." Then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, "Go gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast on my behalf, and neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do. After that, I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish." Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. For such a time as this. Perhaps that's where we find ourselves even today. Over the past few weeks, as I was getting ready for this sermon, I was skimming through the book called First United Methodist Church History, 1859 to 1984. There is actually a published book of this church's history. If you would like a copy, I'm happy to give you one. It's a little light bedtime reading. Someone also this past week, and I can't remember who, left a little piece of paper on my desk with a two-paragraph brief history of this church and some of the other buildings that are around the town. The church's history is a history of the saints who have come before us. And it's a time where people recognize that there was a need for a church, for the kingdom of God to draw near in Sherman, Texas. But the church itself wasn't built by some wealthy person who thought a church would be a good idea. Instead, the church was planted by what we called circuit riders back before the United States was even a country. Men on horseback used to travel all over the place looking for souls to save. They were sent out by the Wesleyan people, by John Wesley and those good folks called Wesleyans. Methodists, and they would go around riding on their horses and preaching the gospel from town to town. They were truly itinerant. They had no place to lay their head. They relied on the hospitality of others around them. They hoped that people would receive Jesus Christ and open not only their hearts, but their homes. They risked their lives. Many people died on the trails as they went from town to town, from village to village, spreading the gospel. And so the first Methodists I have read that were here in this town actually met under a brush arbor in what is now the square in Sherman. From there, and because of that ministry, the Methodist Episcopal Church South, which is a sermon for another day, the Methodist Episcopal Church South was formed in 1859 and continued to meet in the public square, where everybody could hear the preachers preach and hear the hymns being sung and watch people come to worship there. I just love that picture, right, of a body of Christ coming together and singing and worshiping and praying together publicly. The first building came in 1816 with a man named Reverend Binkley as the pastor, hence Binkley Hall on the main campus. It was located on Travis Street. From those circuit riders who risked their lives for the sake of the gospel to the first members of the church, they worshiped, they fellowshipped, they laid a foundation for who we are today. There was no way for them to know what the future would hold, but they understood that God held the future. And I'm sorry for all the static. I have no idea what's happening here. Through the sacrifice and commitment of those early Methodists, the church was born here. Church growth happened. And who knows about church growth? I know about church growth, and it's painful, and it's difficult, and so very often it's ugly. Nobody wants church growth, really, because when you grow a church, things change. And don't we love when everything just stays the same? Don't we love when everything is just like this all the time? Church growth doesn't allow for that. See, church growth looks like this, and nobody likes this in their life. Right? Nobody likes the idea that, well, maybe we'll have to worship in a different space. Oh, maybe we'll have to give a little more money. Oh, maybe we'll have to go serve people we're not really sure we want to serve. That's what those early Methodists experienced as the church grew and flourished under the pastors that came year after year. But church growth in the United Methodist Church, or in the Methodist Church at that time, looked a little different. Because it took not only that congregation's commitment to prayer, worship, service, and financial giving, it took a vision for what God could do in Sherman, Texas. Multiple buildings were built. There's nothing worse than telling someone you're moving. That included the Travis Street Methodist Church that was occupied from 1889 to 1910. And then First Methodist, where the building is currently, grew in 1955. It was on property that was once owned by Kid Key College, which was a Methodist college for women right here in Sherman. In 1968, there was one more change, a change that caused a lot of consternation across the country and perhaps across the world, when the Methodist Church became the United Methodist Church, as the denomination moved to recognize its own forms of racism and its need to be more ecumenical in its dealings with others. There were a number of congregations that called themselves Methodist, but they were not united in their vision or ministry. In 1968, all of that changed on paper. I still believe those are things that we struggle with as a church. In each moment of history, in every local and national struggle, the Methodist Church found itself in its particular time and place, with new demands to meet, with new understandings of what it meant to live as Methodists, doing away with conferences based on color, and ordaining women from the pulpit were two changes made by the church, and it struggled, and it still struggles today with those kinds of changes. These decisions were made, however, by faithful men and women who came together in unity in spite of their differences. They were the saints in their particular time and their particular place, who knew that the gospel demanded that they move beyond cultural norms and embrace the way of Christ. Those who came before us left a courageous legacy of faith, hope, and love that we are now tasked to live into as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. As we celebrate the saints who have gone on to glory today, we are reminded that their lives are no less a reflection of the time and the place that they were born. We are reminded of their joys and their struggles, their moments of faith and doubt, their steps to bring life into seemingly impossible situations. Surely, as we remember parents, grandparents, spouses, siblings, and friends, we can recall their lives and remember perhaps moments of courage, things that seemed impossible that they were willing to either walk into or speak into, that they took because they knew something needed to change, that things were not quite right in their lifetimes. Someone needed to say, this is too important to ignore, and so they took the step to speak into it, to not ignore what was in front of them. As we look forward to our future, we are reminded that in the midst of our current denomination's struggles, in the midst of rising inflation, in the midst of divisive social and political unrest, we living saints are called to such a time as this. I'm going to give an aside here for a moment, because as I was reading the history, it was really interesting to me that, you know, the Methodist Church here in Sherman survived the Depression. And one of the ways it did that was it would actually take people's checks dated into the future. So people were faithful in their giving during the Depression, and they would come to the church, hand in their tithe, and then tell the pastor when that check could get cashed. Right? I mean, they survived the Depression in a building, and they paid for that building, and they continued to serve one another and the community that they lived in. We are not as unique, and no time is good to be doing what we're doing. That's all I can say about that. It was the history of the church and the commitment of the saints that came before us that allow us to even be in this space today. And it took sacrifice, and it wasn't easy, and it's still not easy. Some things are too important. This is important. We are living in a time where we are called to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ no differently than the early circuit riders who came across the frontier to find those who needed to hear the good news. There are people in our community who need to hear the good news. It might seem impossible. The statistics are against us. But there is someone who we know, who you know, who I know, that needs some good news in their life, to know that they are beloved, to know that they have worth and value, to know that whatever is in their past does not define their present or their future. We are the ones called to do that right now. In this day and time, we need to find the courage to live out the faith, hope, and love that Christ demonstrated so that others will know the love of God for themselves. You know, as I think back over the saints in my own life, and not just my family members who are saints, the fact that we stuck together through thick and thin, through things that are too horrendous to even begin to name, I am reminded of those saints who spoke hope into my life over the years. And I realize that we all need saints in our lives. We need to step up and be the saints for others, those who were born for such a time as this, those who are willing to live courageously as Christ lived for us, who gave himself up so that we might have all the things that we have, the freedom to make choices that honor God and honor one another. At the end of that history book, and you know I didn't read it carefully, it's hundreds and hundreds of pages, but I did read the last page. Who else reads the last page? Right? Okay. So I'm glad I'm not alone. The last page of a book before you read the first page of the book. I do that. So I read the last page of the book, and it seemed almost prophetic to me. right? That somebody who published this book, who finished writing it in 1984, it wasn't even published until 1993, wrote these words, and I think it was one of those aha moments. You know, it was interesting, Jerry quoted Ecclesiastes just a minute ago. Ecclesiastes, there's this line in there that says there is nothing new under the sun. There's nothing new under the sun. And I believe that's true. There's nothing that human beings will devise, nothing heinous, nothing good, nothing that hasn't already been said, thought, done in one way or another. And yet God has remained faithful through all of the things, the struggles, the joys, the sorrows, the doubts, and the fears. God has always remained faithful from generation to generation. And so the book closes this way. Now, moving to make new history in a third century of Methodism, this would be fourth, it stands as a sentinel, it, the church, stands as a sentinel of hope as the burden of heritage comes to rest on today's and unborn generations. In this era of denominational decline, there is reason to believe that the same resolute power which has sustained and provided courageous, relentless leadership through the happiness and sorrow, triumph and tragedy, wars and peace, hardships and prosperity will endure, and that custom will prevail, filling pews to overflowing, necessitating the building of larger and better sanctuaries in which to save the lost souls and serve humankind. Every age needs the saints. Every age needs the saints. People who will step up to provide relentless leadership through happiness and sorrow, triumph and tragedy, wars and peace, hardship and prosperity. Because I believe that if the church does nothing else, it brings hope to people who don't even know that tomorrow the sun will rise. This is the job of the saints. This is our call. We must be the church, not just this year, but every year. Through the struggles, through the unrest, through the disagreements, we must be the church to offer a word of grace, a vision for the future that is filled with people living in unity even when we don't agree. This is what it means to be a saint, to give a vision of Christ drawing near, not just back in the first century and not just in our current century, but for the sake of our, not just our children, but our children's children and their children and their children. Because every age needs a saint. Perhaps we are here for such a time as this.
To you.
This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. Whoa. I will make room for you. Whatever you want to. Whatever you want to. Shake up the ground of all my traditions. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Shake up the ground of all my traditions. Break down the walls of all my religion.
As we continue with worship today, and we recognize that today is All Saints, before the prayer this morning, we are going to have a moment of silence, and you will be invited to come forward and to pick up a candle if you want, and light that candle, set it in the sand in memory of someone who you know and love who has gone on to glory. It doesn't have to be someone who went home this year. It could be someone who rests in your heart. And so as I light this first candle, we will sit in silence for a moment, and then I will invite you to come forward and to take a candle and light it. At the end of worship today, if you would like, you can take the candle, a candle, home with you in memory of that person or persons.
I just wanted to say some words to the congregation here. I didn't plan this. She's probably thinking, she is terribly shocked that I'm even up here. The reason why I am, a long time ago, you had a parishioner among you that went over to England. And when she came back, she decided to start a garden at your church in the middle. And Frances Nielsen took over that garden in the 60s. For Master Gardener, and I am the president of Master Gardener for this last 2 years, and my reign is coming to an end. But I wanted to thank you. When I was an intern, I came in, and it was a different garden. So we learn about different landscaping. We learn about English cottage gardens from you all, and we get to tend the garden. We never get paid, but we get paid in knowledge. And I just wanted to thank you all for doing this for us. It helps master gardeners in the intern program to learn about different plants, different gardens, different layouts. And this person decided to set money aside to pay for the garden's expenses because she wanted that garden so bad in your church. So this is something that somebody from your past who has died has left this garden to you all to share. During COVID, this garden meant so much to your ministers that they came out and thanked us for tending it. Because a lot of your men's programs and women's programs were done out in that courtyard because you couldn't go into the building at that time as well. So for all the years that you have been having us and helping us when we needed to have a place to come to teach, I want to thank you for that. And thank you for your parishioner who wanted to do this for you all for all these years. So when you look at that garden, think about your past and this lady who decided to do the garden. And we thank you for that garden. In fact, sometimes you have impromptu weddings at that garden, and a minister will come out and perform one, and three of our master gardeners sat there in their blue jeans and crappy t-shirts, sweating, but seeing these young couples join because they didn't have money for a fancy wedding. So a lot of your old parishioners, 82, 83, also come in and just love that garden. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Can we please have a moment of silence? Will you come?
Thank you. We give you thanks, O God, for all the saints who ever worshipped you, whether in brush arbors or cathedrals, weathered wooden churches or crumbling cement meeting houses, where your name was lifted and adored. We give you thanks, O God, for the hands lifted in praise, manicured hands or handstand with grease or soil, strong hands and those gnarled with age, holy hands, used as wave offerings across the land. We thank you, God, for hardworking saints, whether hard-hatted or steel-booted, head-ragged or aproned, blue-collar or three-piece suited, they left their mark on the earth for you, for us, for our children to come. Thank you, God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by God before us. Bless the memories of your saints, God. May we learn how to walk wisely from their examples of faith, dedication, worship, and love. And now, with the confidence of God's children, we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. The kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
One of the things that Jesus calls us to do is to remember. So remembering isn't just for all saints. Remembering is something we are called to do as God's people. And we do that together. We do it individually, but more importantly, we do it as a community of faith that looks forward in hope, because we know that even if we cannot foretell the future, God is already there. And so we remember that on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, he broke it and gave thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat all of you. This is my body which has been broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave God thanks and praise. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink from this cup, remember me." And so we gather around the table and we remember. When we come to the table, we will see these candles that represent perhaps hundreds of people who we remember on this day. We remember the sacrifice of Christ and all he has done for us. And we know that all that we have been given this day is by the hand of God, and all that we will give to others is by the hand of God. And for the future of this church, it is in the hands of God. And for that we give thanks, and for that we are filled with hope, a hope that does not disappoint us. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, so we might be the body of Christ broken and poured out in love for the world. Help us, O God, to be one with you, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. With Christ, in Christ, through Christ, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Will those who are assisting with communion this morning please come forward? Now let us join together in the prayer following the sacrament. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
And now as we do our final song, we invite you to stand if you feel so led, and let's sing to the Lord. Confidence, you never fail.
promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Never failed me yet.
So receive now this benediction. We all have a legacy that we will leave. All of us will. We'll leave something behind. There'll be something in the dash. When we go, from when we were born to the day that we are no longer on this earth, there will be a legacy and our name will be attached to that. What that will be, I cannot determine for anybody but myself. But this is my hope, that when someone says one of our names, they say they were a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ and they changed my life. May that be the legacy that we all leave amongst all the other things that we can leave. Go in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.